One of the significant events in the world of Christian liturgy was the publication of a document known as the Reims Statement in 2011 on how churches, principally in the English-speaking world, use the scriptures. And the Reims Statement is an important, it's a short document, but it's a very important one. And one of the people whose name is one of the signatories of the Reims Statement is, it just says, Kevin McGinnell, England. And my great joy is that I have Kevin McGinnell here in the studio with me. Kevin, you're very welcome. The Reims Statement is talked about by liturgists in all of the Western Christian churches. Tell us about it, and tell us about its background, and tell us about its significance. So tell us about the statement first, and then tell us about its background.
Okay. The statement came about from the English Language Liturgical Consultation, which has got the unfortunate sound of elk.
But, elk,
but
okay.
But we're not moose in some great forest. But elk was the successor to another body called the International Consultation on English Texts.
That was also known as
ICET. Rather than ICEL.
Yes.
And ICEL was part of both ICET and ELK until a famous day.
Okay.
Now, the Reims Statement came about because, and I can go into the history in a moment or two, because we felt that we no longer were able to continue working necessarily on common texts alone, texts that we would share in the liturgy across the Christian churches. And I'll explain why in terms of the revision that had taken place in the other church, many churches. But we did feel that what we had was a mission. And the mission was to continue the work of ecumenical liturgical cooperation. We had the fantastic development of the Revised Common Lectionary, which with the Roman lectionary has tremendous overlap and works together. So many people were using the same scriptures on the same Sundays in the year. We also had moved away from common texts, and yet what were we going to do instead? And so we came to a couple of very important issues to resolve. The first was to say, how do we continue the work without writing shared texts? And secondly, how do we make sure that this work is seen to be of value? And we thought, once we had met as ELK in Reims in 2011, it would be good if for one day we gathered together a much wider group of liturgical scholars, and you'll see them all listed on the back of the leaflet, from Australia, North America, the United Kingdom, Ireland. And the hope was that we would try and, if you want to do that sort of thing where you went to, said, what has been great about the past? Where are we in the present, and what are our hopes for the future? Just in terms of the past, it was a real statement about the fact that we have achieved a lot since the 1960s. Obviously, the liturgical movement takes us back much before then. But ecumenically, since the 1960s, we've been very involved together in different ways. And the present generation of young liturgists simply have never had to live through what many people found quite painful. So we need to celebrate where we are today, because that has come from the past. In the present, we have the Revised Common Lectionary. We have some churches, or many churches, differing degrees using common texts, but that necessarily has been affected tremendously by the revision of the liturgies of each church. So where do we move to into the future? Into the future, we felt, was to think about what have we in common that we could reflect on together. And that has led us to try and establish, particularly from the Reims Statement, what we hope will be the Leuven Statement in 2017, on a common understanding of the Ordo. And a reflection too, perhaps, on Ars Celebrandi. Because if you go down any high street of any town in anywhere in the world, really, you will find Christian churches. And they will be celebrating on different sides of the street, something that if you didn't know what was going on, you would see tremendous similarities in. And those similarities are something we need to celebrate, because it's in finding the commonality that we can actually both celebrate what we have and also actually acknowledge our debt to one another and find out where in fact we can resource one another. So that really is the basis of the Reims Statement. But I think the most important thing for us to think about in the Reims Statement is the fact that in 1960, I'm sure you'd know the same, we had a tremendous advance in the Catholic Church when we were allowed to go into a Protestant church for a service, so long as we didn't say the Protestant Our Father.
Remember it well, yeah. Alas.
And when you look at, and that came from a time when we weren't even allowed to go into a Protestant church.
I remember the Methodists next door, my mother and the lady, she's now long dead, they were the best of friends. Mm. When her daughter was getting married in 65, we went up and waited outside the church door at the gate with our confetti, because the local parish priest had said, you can't even step inside the grounds to cast your confetti.
And I think this was the same true of Protestants and Catholic churches. So I think what we have to do is to say that we've moved from a period where we were literally strangers one to another, liturgically, as well as in lots of other areas of theology, into a time now where we do actually have common prayer together in different ways. We have a common understanding of the liturgical and of life together. We will attend other people's services. Even the Directory on Ecumenism allows for particular moments when we can even share, to a degree, some form of Eucharistic intercommunion, limited as it may be between Roman Catholics and others. So one of the things that we're trying to say as well is that we need to come back and say to people who have never experienced those difficulties, do you know what people had to go through? Sacrifices people made, struggles that people went through to achieve what they have now. And so when then people have in fact said, well, common text, that's what we have always done, they need to remember that prior to 1970 there was very little of it at all. And that I think that the Reims Statement is trying to say, that we've moved in a fantastic way, we've achieved a lot, we have a treasure in the Revised Common Lectionary that we need to promote, and in a sense the more we can promote that across all of the language areas, the better. We too need to celebrate the common texts that still exist. But where can we move to? I think we can move to talking to one another much more deeply about the very principles of liturgical life, Christian liturgical life, and in celebrating that, perhaps find a way then of even perhaps returning to common texts for the next edition of all of our liturgical books. It's important to just add that one of the reasons why we moved away from common liturgical texts was that there was a spate of revision of the liturgies of many, many churches. So for instance, common worship in the Church of England, or the Methodist service book, or the Baptist service book in this country anyway. All of the work of the other Anglican provinces. And just very subtly, as these were introduced, there were divergences made from the common texts. And then clearly with the latest translation of the Roman Missal, the Roman Church moved very strongly away from it. So all in all, what we've had to do now is to say that common texts are at a particular stage. They're still there to a degree. Are they something that we need to aim for? Well, perhaps our only way of moving back to them is by exploring how we celebrate liturgy together to see if the need is there for them.
And of course that raises the larger question about ecumenism. Is ecumenism trying to sort out problems that happened centuries ago, the legacy of which is you can't redo the past, or whether ecumenism is to say, well, there was never really church unity, but there was a time when Christian communities were prepared to loan and learn and borrow from one another. In fact, that's the sort of network we see in the oikoumene of the first century. It's that actually that generated things like the four canonical gospels, that community shared texts, and these were passed around. And so learning from one another is actually a different way of doing ecumenism.
Absolutely, because at the end of the day, what we had to work with, say in the 60s, was living in division. Not that it was a false hope that we'd all end up doing the same thing, But I think there was a sort of what we used to talk about, there's the ecumenical spring and these sort of things. And there were great times. But I think slowly we realised that we needed to actually celebrate also our own identities, because we are products of our own history. And our own history has always been positive. It's given us positive things. And we've reflected those in the liturgy. So the issue about the ecclesiology shaping the liturgy, the old, you know, ars credendi, is very important, really. And I think we need to come back and say, we want to celebrate that. We want to celebrate our differences, because our differences can enrich one another. In the same sense that everybody's acknowledging how the Roman lectionary sparked off something fantastic with the other understanding of lectionaries. So too, I think we've rediscovered in the Roman Church the value of the great hymn writers of other traditions. And perhaps we are now giving back with other sorts of music to people. And I think obviously the whole notion of music in the liturgy could well be another thing that we might begin to discover and actually learn from one another.
Kevin, obviously the first step is for people to go and read the Reims Statement. And in the credits of this video, we'll give the link for where it can be downloaded from the internet. And what you're saying is the Reims Statement is a spot on a line, and it's really an agenda for moving forward.
It is, and what we're hoping is already that we're talking about this colloquium in Louvain in 2017 on Ordo and Ars Celebrandi. We hope that that will spark another one perhaps in 4 or 5 years after that. Because in a sense, what we're about is trying to discover what we need. We needed to be able to pray together with the same language, in the same language and using the same words, to feel that commonality. Perhaps we don't need the words now together. It may be the symbols, the actions, the thinking, the liturgical theology. And it's by working along those lines, because in a certain sense, just having common words doesn't mean that we're actually expressing the same thought. So it's that deeper level of liturgical integration, I think, that we need to work with.
Kevin, thank you very much.
You're very welcome indeed. Thank you.